Hello everybody, welcome to the next couple of hours of lecture where we're going to be talking about modeling in the pharmaceutical industry in the context of drug development. My name is Rukmini Kumar. I started off with a PhD in physics and then I went on to computational biology. In the last 15 years or so, I've been working in this industry. So who I represent, I work and I co-founded this company called Vantage Research. We're a small company in Chennai. We're about 12 multidisciplinary scientists. What we do is we develop mathematical models of physiological systems. That's one of the big things that we do, and we collaborate with big pharma working on important drug development projects across the world. So that's basically what we do. We worked in many different disease areas, diabetes, immuno-oncology, nutrition, autoimmune diseases such as rheumatoid arthritis, psoriasis, etc. So what I would like to convey to you in the next couple of hours is not only the technical aspects of why modeling is important in the pharma industry, but also the fact that it can really move and improve drug development in very interesting ways. And I'd like to emphasize that point in the next couple of hours. Okay, excellent. So the key points I'd like you to leave with are the following. How does drug discovery happen today? I think everybody in general may have a vague idea about the various pieces involved. I'd like you to leave with a more concrete notion of how that happens from end to end. I'd like you to then think about how does modeling help. So once we understand drug discovery, what problems there are, how does modeling help in that industry? In particular, the kind of models that I work on are mechanistic physiological models. So this is a field called quantitative and systems pharmacology, or QSP for short. And I'd like to kind of immerse you into that world, the methods, the techniques, the challenges, what do we face in this area. Then to make it real, we'll talk about an example of type 2 diabetes. I love to talk about diabetes in the context of modeling because it's a disease which touches many, many lives. And you know, usually I ask how many people in the audience know how have family members that have diabetes, and usually it's a sizable number. So we can talk about diabetes and the kind of model that helps in diabetes. And I'd like to conclude at the end by talking about the role of engineers, people with quantitative skill sets in pharma drug and development. Okay, excellent. So when you think about what is a drug and what does it do, really the image that should come in your head is some pharmacological agent. Usually it's a small chemical, sometimes it's a protein that is given to a large number of individuals, a population that is pre-identified, and then it causes a particular change that you want in that population. So for instance, if it's a drug for diabetes, you want to see a reduction in blood glucose. If it's a drug for hypertension, you want to see a reduction in blood pressure or tumor size if you're going after an oncology drug. On the other hand, there are some drugs that can increase, you know, you want to increase bone density, you want to increase muscle mass, those are possibilities as well. At the end of the day, you want some agent that changes something clinically meaningful in a person. But that's a large kind of macro scope. I'm sure all of you understand that at the end of the day, what a drug does is going down multiple layers. So when you think of the human body, it's not just all the people who buy drugs in the pharmacy. There's a lot of magic going on, a lot of black box actually going on underneath those layers. There's the molecular networks, cellular networks, organ tissue networks, and then that those can be extremely variable, and that leads to the population. And what we usually know is the drug manipulates something in one of these networks, in a cellular network or a molecular network, and our job is to identify how that percolates up to the population so that we have meaningful and safe results. So like I said, for this talk, I'd like to talk about diabetes as an exemplar disease. Again, I'd love to ask, how many of you know or have family members who suffer from diabetes? How many of these family members do you know that inject themselves with insulin once or twice a day? So yeah, so this is a disease, much as we understand, is a modern scourge. So the diabetes has been recorded from historic and prehistoric times. There's you know, evidence from ancient Egypt from about 1500 BC about the description of diabetes as a disease where there's emaciation, lot of urination, weight loss, tiredness, dehydration. And all the way to today, on the right hand side, what you see there is epidemiological data collected from a group in Chennai actually, which talks about the prevalence of diabetes in modern India. This is rural, urban, and if you go into the paper, you will see that it's across high, low socioeconomic classes. Over age is what this graph shows. At the age of between 20 and 24, what starts at 5%, it's also a disease of age and metabolic conditions. So it kind of increases all the way to 25-30% as people grow older. It's a major cause of public health concern and cost and human suffering. So that's what we want to talk about. Now it's a strange thing. We talk about diabetes, the ancient Egyptians knew about it. Today we know about it, our family members go into the pharmacy to buy drugs for diabetes, but how do you go from one to the other? How do you go from seeing someone who's dehydrated and emaciated and figuring out what drug they need? So again, we all have an understanding of how that process in between starts, but I'll talk about the development of insulin as a treatment for diabetes. How do we know we want to treat diabetics with insulin? So the first thing which is of interest is anatomy itself. So early in 1860, people identified an organ called the islets of Langerhans. So these are sitting near the pancreas. So that was interesting. That's something that is a curiosity. But as we accumulated knowledge, there were animal experiments, and in these experiments, what they found was when you had dogs and you did pancreatitis to them. So you know, why the experiment came about is a harder question to ask, and there's plenty of books written about the history of development of insulin. But what they found, this group Minkowski and Von Behring, was if you take the pancreas out of dogs, out of healthy dogs, they have symptoms of diabetes. So they urinate excessively, they show extreme tiredness, and at that point we're also measuring blood glucose. So they see all of those symptoms in those dogs. So okay, that's curious. The pancreas is somehow important, and not having the pancreas causes symptoms of diabetes. Then in kind of fascinating and pivotal work, a group from the University of Toronto, Banting, what they did was they isolated the secretion from the pancreas, which was insulin. They injected back the insulin to pancreatitic dogs whose pancreas have been removed, and they found that injection alleviated the symptoms of diabetes. So here's a dog, you take out the pancreas, symptoms of diabetes, you inject back something that is secreted from the pancreas into the dog, and the symptoms are alleviated. Okay, we're on to something. So in what may have been the quickest turnaround between something that was discovered in a lab to something that was manufactured as a drug, by late 1920, 1930, insulin was produced, mass produced by a pharma company called Eli Lilly and marketed to people with diabetes. So before this, we think of diabetes as a lifestyle disease, but before this, diabetes could be a life sentence. That means, you know, you either lose your leg, or if you have type 1 diabetes, you watch children die, and there's not much you can do. So this changed the way people think about diabetes. But at that time, what's interesting is we're still in the dark ages when it comes to the genomic revolution. So people, to make insulin, what they had to do was look at other mammals like pigs and cows, take their pancreas, crush them up, extract the right amount of insulin, and then put it in little vials to sell. So that was kind of, you know, still very path breaking, but when we look back, that's kind of a very difficult way to do these things. Then in the 60s, Sanger, by this time we know the structure of the DNA, we know the DNA, RNA, and we've got the fundamentals of molecular biology, and insulin is sequenced. Once insulin is sequenced, then we know we can generate insulin using recombinant technology, and then Genentech and Eli Lilly, by the time in 1980s, they were mass producing recombinant insulin. They still marketed recombinant human insulin to distinguish it from the cow and the pig insulin that we had before, and that was kind of again another path breaking development. So here you have end to end kind of the fascinating story, And there's a lot of drama and, you know, human element in the story going from one arc to the other. I have presented a very simple story here. But you can see all of the various elements that go into identifying what the problem is, finding what the solution to the problem is, generating that solution, mass producing it, and then making sure it reaches the right people. So that's kind of that history which spanned about 100 years or so. Now, what we want to do is to bottle this magic. So we want to be able to, you know, go after difficult diseases, find what the problem is, find the right solution, and find a way to get out of, you know, to find the way to solve these things. So if you kind of distill what happened in the, what I showed in the last thing, really you have, you know, what structure of chemical you want, you have all of this accumulated knowledge. From there, you want to do what is called a randomized control trial, and I'll talk about that in a second. But basically what you want to do is you want to make sure that the drug works in humans that need it. And once that's done, success, the drug works and it can be administered to anybody that wants it. So one of the key things that we should understand in modern drug development is the concept of a randomized clinical trial. So here what I've shown is you recruit, say 100 people, you want them to be case matched, you want them to be very similar 100 people. Then you divided them into two groups of 50 each. To one group, you give your standard of care, whatever regularly people gave for diabetes. Maybe it's metformin, maybe it's not much at that time. So you just leave them as it is. To the other group, you give them your drug of choice. Now you have to be very careful with a randomized control trial. Usually these are double blind as well. In the sense, neither the patient nor the physician knows which is the control arm and the trial arm. So if you're injecting the trial arm with insulin, you have to find an injection with just serum or nothing in it to inject the control arm. So once this double blind trial, where neither the patient nor the physician knows what the drug is or who's getting treated, once that proceeds, then at the end of the trial, in a predetermined time, in 4 months and 6 months, you ask the question whether the treated people showed better symptoms or was their disease improved compared to the untreated group. So this is a hard bar to cross, and there's a lot of complications about placebo effects, etc. So that's a whole other thing. But the point that I want to make is drug development is challenging, and oftentimes we hear about anecdotal things. You know, herbal treatment, this worked, another therapy worked, but the bar to cross for a treatment to work for everybody and to be signed off by authorities such as the FDA, the EMEA, Indian authorities and such, is that you have to cross a randomized controlled trial. So that's ideally the process that drug development takes. Is it, do you expect that it will be this smooth every time? You know, nothing is that smooth in real life. So going from this part of discovery chemistry, preclinical is anything that happens in animal models, not humans. So animals or you know, in vitro systems, anything that happens is preclinical. From there to clinical, which happens in humans, and then to what is in the real world, that's the thread. But nothing is that simple. All kinds of questions come up. So as you can imagine, very early in the chemistry, you're not exactly sure how your, you know, the protein or the molecule you're designing should be. So oftentimes companies have, you know, one early molecule, one late molecule with different properties. The other thing is, what is the right thing to measure? In diabetes, it's somewhat easy, you measure glucose. But in other diseases like arthritis, do you have, and does anybody have family members with arthritis? Fewer, but it's a disease of inflammation, and often patients have a lot of pain in their joints. So then it's much harder to find what is the point of clinical efficacy. So what is the best biomarker to use? That can be something that, you know, you people struggle with when going from stage one to stage two. Very critical questions which modelers often answer is, how much should I dose? Who should get a bigger or smaller dose? Should that scale with the body weight of a person? Should that scale with the severity of disease? Somebody who's very diabetic versus somebody who's mildly diabetic, should they get different amounts of drug? All of those questions are important. Then often when the drug, in these clinical trials are usually conducted in hundreds, maybe thousands of patients. Then once you go into the real world and the drug is approved to be sold in the real world, then it could be potentially administered to millions of people. Then you may start seeing signals that you didn't see just because you have a much larger sample. Then you have to worry both about the safety and the efficacy. So those are again two important concepts in drug development, safety and efficacy. We've been talking about efficacy, which is if you're diabetic, I want to reduce your plasma glucose. But we also have to make sure that we don't make you sicker, we don't make you faint because your glucose has gone too low. So safety and efficacy are two sides of the same coin. So should we worry, you know, what happens when you give the drug to millions of patients? Are you expecting to see safety signals that you did not see in thousands of patients? So these are all just a snippet of some of the real world concerns that scientists in drug development face. The crux of the matter is drug development is in fact very inefficient. So you may ask the question, you go to the pharmacy, you see so many medicines up there. What does it take? Like how long does it take to go from idea to something being at the pharmacy? How much money does it take? You know, how much should a pharma company, a government, etc. invest to get this drug out? The numbers are actually staggering. Of late, I think the estimate is it takes about 10 plus years to go from end to end of the process. So we were talking about one end being chemistry, the other end being the FDA review. It can take a decade. It can take $1 billion because the science is hard to do, and then clinical trials can be expensive to do. So you want to run your trials in as efficient a manner as possible, and you want to make this entire process as efficient and smart as possible, not only because you'll be saving money and time. Time is important because then you reach drugs sooner to people that need them. And the other thing is when you have more efficient experimentation, you're saving animals and humans from potential harm. So that's the challenge that you know, modern drug development is. Any questions, any kind of pre-existing notions that you have that you'd like to talk about? So at the end of the day, a lot of you are interested in biology. I think it's fascinating because biology is in some ways a new frontier for a lot of knowledge to be discovered. But this is the applied side of biology. At the end of the day, you want biology to impact health. You want biology to make better drugs for people. You want biology to help people live for longer, healthier. So this is where kind of the rubber meets the road when we're trying to get academic kind of our knowledge applied to the real world. So let's change gears a little bit and talk about how does modeling help. You know, why should we do modeling? What do people who do modeling do in drug development today?